Actually start off this presentation with a Quran recitation by a master reciter, Hajj Maria Alfa. So if you'll indulge me for just a couple of minutes.
Going to give you the words to go with.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Idha as-samaa'u faṭarat wa idha al-kawākibu intathart wa idha al-biḥāru fujjirat. وَإِذَا الْقُبُورُ بُعْثِرَتْ عَلِمَتْ نَفْسٌ مَا قَدَّمَتْ وَأَخَّرَتْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْإِنسَانُ مَا غَرَّكَ بِرَبِّكَ الْكَرِيمِ الَّذِي خَلَقَكَ فَسَوَّاكَ فَعَدَلَكَ في أي صورة ما شاء ركبك كلا بل تكذبون بالدين وإن عليكم لحافظين كراما كاتبين يعلمون ما تفعلون إن الأبرار لفي نعيم وإن الفجار لفي جحيم يصلونها يوم الدين وما هم عنها بغائب.
Sorry, I do not know what happened.
وما أدراك ما يوم الدين ثم ما أدراك ما يوم يوم لا تملك نفس لنفس شيئا والأمر يومئذ لله صدق الله العظيم.
So these are the lyrics to Surah 84 that Hajj Maria was just reciting for us. One of the reasons why I wanted to start with Hajj Maria Alfa is because oftentimes our image that pops into our mind of Muslim women is of an Arab woman, and there are actually more Muslims living in Indonesia than there are in the entire Middle East combined, about 300 million of them. We also generally have this expectation, maybe not so much with your group, but certainly in many other denominations, that religious leaders are supposed to be male. And so shaking that up a little bit by introducing you to a master reciter and teacher, hopefully will give you an idea of some of the kinds of roles that women today are playing. She actually runs her own series of schools called Pesantren to teach other young women how to recite the Quran, her voice is considered to be about 1 in 10 million. She's considered to be that exceptional of a reciter. And in the Muslim world, especially in Southeast Asia, there are competitions, both national and international, for Quran recitation. Hajj Maria has won a number of them. There are all sorts of prizes that are offered, cash, television, refrigerators. They have to hold them in football stadiums because they are so popular and they have major parades going to them. The ultimate prize is an all-expense-paid trip to go on Hajj. And the Hajjah at the beginning of Hajj Maria Alfa indicates that she's somebody who has been
on that pilgrimage. So contrast that image to, oh, perhaps something like this, which is what we are frequently bombarded with in the news. We've certainly all seen this sort of picture. My point tonight is not to say that such women don't exist or that their circumstances are not challenging, because they truly are in many cases, but they really don't tell us the whole picture of what it's like to be a Muslim woman. We often hear in the media that Islam oppresses women. And one African-American Muslim woman who put it to me this way: I've been told that as a Muslim woman, I'm oppressed, repressed, suppressed, depressed, and every other kind of press there is. But no one ever asked me what my understanding of Islam is or how I feel Islam treats women. And ain't I a Muslim? And yes, that is a nod to Sojourner Truth there. What we're really seeing in the late 20th, since the late 20th and early 21st centuries, is that Muslim women are increasingly inserting their voices into conversations about faith and theology, especially calling for greater attention to what they see as the egalitarian vision outlined in the Quran. We don't necessarily always see it at the societal or political levels, but many Muslim women, when they read the Quran, find that to be extremely empowering. And so the argument is that if you want to engage in really effective reforms, those arguments must necessarily be rooted in the words of the Quran itself. Many people can debate about the parameters of Islamic law and what represents a particular culture or context, but the Quran is the divinely revealed word of God. It's the one thing that no one is able to challenge. And what's really interesting about that is that Muslim women have been involved in the Muslim community since the very beginning. We know that Prophet Muhammad had both female and male companions. We know that women were strong and equal participants in that endeavor. We know that even after the Prophet's death in the early years, there were some men who tried to preach particular messages, and there were women who said, excuse me, it didn't quite happen that way. This is what I remember Prophet Muhammad as having said. And these men would back down. Even Caliph Omar, who was the second caliph in Islam, who was known for being a very strong figure, when he was corrected in the public space, stepped down in favor of a woman. And so that is the kind of spirit and voice that many women activists today are trying to recapture. One of the most prominent of those voices, I'm very sorry, I don't know why it keeps doing that.
I think if you turn off your Wi-Fi, it's...
Oh, is that what the problem is? All right. If we have a computer god here who could provide me with some help, that would be really amazing right now. And all right, our help has departed, so we are just going to plow through and hope that we can get this to work. So we have here Amina Wadood, wrote a very important work called Quran and Woman back in the 1990s. And she called for a more egalitarian approach to male-female social dynamics in keeping with that egalitarian vision of women and men as being equal in the eyes of God. She considers herself a progressive Muslim. She's been a leading voice in women's activism and spent some time in Malaysia working at the foundation of an organization called Sisters in Islam, which is working for reform to family law. And then she returned here to the United States to teach at Virginia Commonwealth University. The picture on the right shows her doing something extremely controversial. She was one of the first women to actually lead a mixed-gender prayer service. That was so controversial, they had to change the location three times because of bomb threats that had come in. She received death threats at her home. According to tradition, women are only supposed to lead other women in prayer, and if you have men or a mixed-gender congregation, only a man is supposed to lead that. Except, there is one example, at least, from Prophet Muhammad's own lifetime, of him appointing a woman as the head of her household to serve as the prayer leader for them. And so the challenge is that if this was good enough for Prophet Muhammad, who's anybody else to try to override that? She ended up leading her first mixed-gender prayer in South Africa in 1994, did the same thing in New York City in 2005. And yet, despite all of her work in the aftermath of 9/11, when the media was looking for Muslims to interview on television, she said, you know, I'm certainly Muslim enough to have been harassed. I've been woman enough for people to look at the visible signs of my Islam with my veil. But the media decided to cancel her out of the programs once they realized that she was African American. And so she's calling also for restoring the African American voice to Islam. They represent about a third of all Muslims in the United States, and yet are very marginalized. If you're interested in reading the book of her memoir, she's written a book called Inside the Gender Jihad, talking about what it's like to be a Muslim woman in the trenches. So how much of an argument does she really have? This is a verse from the Quran that talks about the creation of the first two human beings coming from a single soul, and that they are created together at the same time. You'll note that it doesn't say that one is created before the other. It doesn't say that one was created and that God went and did a whole bunch of other things and created other stuff and then finally got around to creating a woman. Here we have the idea of two soulmates from the beginning who are split apart, which gives us the sense that in order for any one of us to be complete again, we have to find that other half of ourselves. It may particularly interest you to know that the term zauj for mate is one of the rare words in Arabic that is neither masculine nor feminine. And so even having the creation of that mate doesn't indicate that one came first or second. In fact, the most important word here would be nafs, which happens to be a feminine word. Another passage that talks about the equality of men and women in terms of what God expects of them and what God promises as rewards to them comes to us from chapter 9. And note that God here specifies that believers, both male and female, because Arabic follows a linguistic convention in which women are often wrapped into the masculine plural. So the goal here is to make it very clear that this is not a verse that is only talking about men, but also talks about women. And they are responsible for protecting each other. They are held accountable for fulfilling the same ritual practices. And note that they are both promised exactly the same reward if they are faithful to what God has asked of them. Another passage we might look at has God reassuring people that regardless of whether you're male or female, whatever works you do in this life, God will credit to you. So you don't have to worry about your gender having some sort of negative impact on you. God also recognizes that injustice and oppression occur to both men and women, and God promises to remember that and to offer reward in the afterlife. But perhaps one of the most powerful verses is this one that comes to us from chapter 33. And this verse was actually revealed in response to a question that was asked to Prophet Muhammad by a woman. She said, you know, it seems oftentimes that God speaks in vague language or that God only talks to men. And so I'd really like to know what our status is. And this verse was revealed in response to that question. And in the original Arabic, there's this lilting sort of rhyme, because you have this pattern of believing men and believing women, submitting men and submitting women. There's a sense here of balance that is created between the genders. And note that all of these characteristics that God expects apply to both of them, and God promises both of them the same reward in the end. So what happened? We have this wonderful vision in Scripture. What often happens is that religion, as it plays out over time and space, we find that other practices and cultures from the surrounding context end up being incorporated into the original practice and vision. Particularly, we find during the spread, of the Islamic Empire, that certain types of attitudes and behaviors were adopted from surrounding societies. We have certain issues, particularly related to what the appropriate roles are for men and women in the family, where we have greater emphasis being played on, given to men as the breadwinners and women as being more fragile and in need of being taken care of. We have veiling, which I'm going to go into in a moment. really being introduced more as an issue from outside cultures, that veiling was a status symbol in surrounding cultures, in Sasanian and Byzantine culture. And if you were a man, you were able to keep your wife at home and keep her veiled so that she was not available for public view. That was a sign of your status and the fact that you had arrived in society as a man. So this came to be incorporated over time. If you're interested in reading more about that, Leila Ahmed has written a wonderful book on women and gender in Islam. Some of the kinds of challenges that Muslim women face today, one of them you may have heard that in an Islamic court, a woman's testimony only counts for half of that of a man's. And so the argument goes that in the context of early Islamic Arabia, men were more likely than women to have access to public space. They were more likely to be experienced in the market. They were more likely to have experience in the court systems. And they were also able to be more independent people. And so the idea was that if you had two women who had to come and testify together, that they would be able to support each other, and one, as the Quran says, could remind the other in case she forgot about something important. Those conditions do in fact exist in some places today, but it's not the reality everywhere. And so there are some Muslim women activists who are calling for a change to this, to recognize equal testimony from both men and women on the basis of achievement of education and also having professional experience. One woman in particular I know in Saudi Arabia said she finds it just absolutely ridiculous that when she goes to the court, there she is as the CEO of her company. She has a graduate degree in, she's an MBA, and yet an illiterate, uneducated man can come and his testimony counts for twice as much as hers does. And so the argument here is that we have to consider the context in which the verses were originally revealed, but then we also need to consider the context in which we live today, because there's been such a change in that context. It's time to reform some of these practices. Another area where that has been an issue has been in Egypt, and we're talking Egypt before the Arab Spring. How long Muslim women are going to be able to hold on to some of the rights they've won remains open to question for many of us. That issue that I mentioned about men being expected to be the breadwinners and women not being required to make a financial contribution to the home was represented in marriage contracts. That at the time when a marriage is undertaken, the man is supposed to offer a dower. That's not a dowry. Is a dower. A dowry would be paid to the bride's father. A dower is supposed to be paid to the bride herself. The idea here is that because she's not working outside of the home, that she needs to have some kind of financial means to be able to support herself in the event of death or divorce by the husband. In exchange for the husband taking care of the cost of living, raising the children, whatever her maintenance happens to be, she provides care for the household and raises the children. However, the reality today in many places is that two incomes are required for a household, and that is certainly the case in Egypt. And so Egyptian women have successfully argued before the court that because they have to make a greater contribution to the household, therefore their rights in divorce should also be expanded. That men typically have a unilateral right to divorce. They don't have to provide any justification or reason for it whatsoever, other than the desire to divorce a wife. Women are very limited in terms of the grounds on which they can seek divorce. And so the argument here is that if they have to take over some of the roles that men have been playing in the past, and they ought to receive some of the rights that men have had exclusive access to as well. Not everyone is on board with that approach because we are talking about a major change to a long-standing tradition, but it is an idea that's being talked about more. Well, probably the most visible symbol of being Muslim would be wearing veils. And many of us in the West have been trained to see this as a symbol of oppression. Part of what I'm getting at with this picture here is there are many different ways in which veils can be worn. The burqa, which is the third from the left, you can only really find that in Afghanistan. It's starting to spread to other locations, but that was really the only location where that existed. Niqab, which is the second from the left, we frequently see in Gulf countries, and we are starting to see more of that spreading to the United States and Europe. The chador in the bottom right corner is typical of Iran. Sometimes we see that in Iraq. The shayla over here on the left is something that one might see more in Pakistan. And so the idea here is that there are many different ways in which you can cover your hair or represent modesty. Some people really prefer to make sure that it's covered and held in place very tightly. Others will simply just wrap around and toss a scarf over the shoulder. These are the sorts of pictures that we see sometimes in the media, and the assumption is that women would only wear a veil if they are forced to, but it doesn't take into account images like this, that veils don't have to be black, they don't have to completely cover your face. In fact, one of the major inputs into the fashion industry today has to do with designing stylish hijabs and abayas and different outfits that you can wear that are more expressive of personal tastes. So, because the veiling is a relatively widespread phenomenon, sometimes people wonder what the Quran actually says about it. And so we'll take you through the most important verses. This verse is called the verse of the hijab. Hijab is a word that we tend to use to describe the veil. It may interest you to know that that word only appears in the Quran 7 times. So perhaps not a terribly important word. Even more interestingly, in none of those cases does hijab refer to an article of clothing that is intended to cover the body. The Arabic root of that term means to screen or seclude or to cover. And so all of the usages of this term in the Quran actually talk about a barrier, or a partition that are meant to produce separation between two sides. So you will have a separation between God and mortals, or between wrongdoers and righteous people, or believers and unbelievers, or light from darkness. Even if we look at popular definitions historically of this term hijab, we find that it was used to describe amulets that you would carry on your person as a sort of protective device. This was particularly done for children or people who were viewed to be in a vulnerable state. The idea here was that you were putting a barrier between that person and harm or danger. The eyebrow was actually referred to as a sort of hijab because it's there to protect the eye. It was also used to refer to an official who would screen the caliph from unwanted audiences and people who were seeking to meet him. And so it's very clear that this term is actually used to describe a protective barrier rather than an item of clothing. Note also that it is not necessarily tied to women. This particular verse that I have up here is called the verse of the hijab, and it was revealed just after Prophet Muhammad had married a lovely lady named Zainab. And as happens with wedding feasts, people like to come and they like to celebrate together, and then sometimes guests aren't very good about leaving. They like to come and hang around and eat food, and the Prophet was getting a little bit frustrated because he wanted to get on with his wedding night with his new wife. And so God decided to intervene for him and provide them with some proper instructions. So here's a tip. If you ever go to the Middle East and you are invited to someone's home for a meal, visiting takes place before the meal. Americans usually sit around and look at each other awkwardly because we don't really know what we're supposed to do. We might have a couple of little things to eat, but we're not used to spending an hour or two before the meal waiting for somebody to hurry up and serve it. Why? Because we expect that we're going to be hanging around after the meal to share some more. That's actually considered to be very rude. You go, you eat your meal, and when the meal is over, you are to leave. And that's how you're supposed to get your wedding guests out of your house so that you can enjoy your wedding night. So as we get to the end part of the verse, it says, when you ask them, and this is a reference to Muhammad's wives, for something, that you should ask for it from behind a curtain. So here's where we see this term hijab appear. And there was concern at this time, this was after the Prophet had moved to Medina and was serving as both a head of state and prophet, that everybody and their brother was coming to visit because they had questions they wanted to ask, they wanted to have a personal conversation with him, and if they couldn't get to him, well, you go to the next closest person, right? It would be one of his wives. And some members of the community were concerned that maybe this wasn't appropriate and that maybe, you know, people shouldn't have as much access to his wives, that perhaps it was insulting to Muhammad's status for anybody and everybody to be wandering in off the street and talking to his wives. And so here we have a separation or a barrier being placed between his wives and the general public as a matter of protecting them and also making sure that nobody would be lusting after his wives, bless you, or marrying them after Muhammad's death. The only other place in the Quran where the term hijab is used to refer to a situation involving a woman actually involves the Virgin Mary, the mother of Jesus. And this occurs in chapter 19, which is actually the only chapter of the Quran that is named for a woman, Maryam, reference to Mary. And it talks about Mary having become pregnant, secluding herself from her family so that she has some private time. So another verse that often comes up is this verse. It's called the mantle verse. And here the term that's used for a garment that's supposed to cover the woman is jilbab. We don't know exactly what this garment looks like, and this is the only time this particular word appears in the Quran. We don't really have much of a description of it, other than that it seems to be a very loose-fitting article of clothing. It's intended to cover the upper part of the body, so presumably the neck and the bosom. So it's worn as a sort of cloak. It's not referred to as a hijab. But what's important here is that it tells us why women are supposed to wear this. It's not supposed to render them invisible. Really, we're doing exactly the opposite thing here by rendering them visibly Muslim in order to protect them from being harassed. And when you look deeper into the literature, you find out that the occasion for revelation of this verse comes to us from reports about Muhammad's sayings and deeds. Apparently, harassment of women in Medina was so widespread at this time that any woman who dared to venture out of her house at night, even if she was just going outside to relieve herself, ran the risk of being assaulted. This also occurs in a cultural context in which slave women were understood to be available to free men for sex. And so the jilbab was supposed to be a visual marker indicating that this was not a slave woman, this was a free woman, she was not publicly sexually available, and that furthermore she was someone who was to be respected and to retain her dignity. We do find the terminology of jilbab appear in the Islamic legal and theological literature, particularly between the 9th and the 15th centuries. And what's really interesting about that is that even though the descriptions in the minds of these exegetes as to what this garment should look like vary, the purpose that it was supposed to serve, preventing harassment, was very consistent across the literature. One other verse, often called the modesty verse, talks about the importance of maintaining one's modesty. Typically, when this verse is cited, they leave out the first part of it, which speaks to men, not just to women. So this is not a burden that women are uniquely expected to bear, but rather God starts off by telling believing men that they should lower their glances, not be looking women straight in the eye, and that they should also be guarding their private parts so that those are not on public display, and reminding them that God is very well aware of everything that they do. Women are supposed to also lower their glances and guard their private parts and not show adornments beyond what is normally visible. We don't have a full description of what exactly that means. But here's one of the really interesting points about this, that in order for believing men and believing women to have a need to lower their glances before each other that would indicate that they must be meeting each other in public space. And so it seems that that was an expectation that this was going to occur, and so a protocol is being established here. There's also a very long list of people to whom women are not supposed to show their, quote, adornments, so their husbands would be an obvious category. The other people in these categories are people who would not be potential marriage partners to them, and so there's an idea here of protecting that woman's beauty as something that should belong most appropriately to her husband. Final statement oftentimes strikes people as a bit unusual. They should not stomp their feet so as to reveal their adornments they have hidden. Wearing ankle bracelets was a very popular thing at the time. This was a favorite verse of those wonderful people, the Taliban, in Afghanistan. They didn't like for women to wear high-heeled shoes, and they were prohibited from wearing ankle bracelets in public space because, God forbid, they might stomp their feet to call attention to themselves. So we often find that there seems to be a lot of fear associated with any exposure of women. In terms of what the shamar looks like, we believe it was some sort of a headscarf or shawl that was supposed to cover any skin that would have been exposed over the neckline of a garment. It does not appear to have functioned as a veil per se, because note that they're supposed to draw it over their bosoms. It doesn't say anything about drawing it over their hair. It's also very interesting to note that it apparently was not intended to cover a woman's face either, because if her face was covered, there wouldn't be any need for men to lower their gazes. One final interesting point is that khimar is not used exclusively for women. It can also refer to a man's turban. That might argue against it meaning some kind of veil. And so ultimately the purpose here is that men and women are supposed to act and dress modestly, and each member is responsible for policing themselves and controlling themselves when they encounter someone of the opposite sex. It is not intended to imply that anyone's body is necessarily dirty or polluting, but rather the idea here is more one of treating the body with respect and dignity. And so what we see with respect to modest dress described in the Quran is that it really has three purposes. Safeguarding the privacy of home life so that public and private spaces enjoy some separation. Protecting Muslim women from sexual harassment and assault when they are outside of the home. And then providing us with a protocol or some guidelines that are supposed to help to regulate interactions between unrelated men and unrelated women. There are some women in the West in particular who have taken issue with point number two, noting that in a Western context, wearing a veil seems to be sadly more likely to get you harassed and assaulted these days, particularly in the aftermath of 9/11. And there are stories ranging from women who just happen to be walking on the street, even to situations in schools where young girls are having boys run through the hallways ripping their veils off of them. It is an incredibly disrespectful thing to do, because part of what you're doing is taking agency away from a woman. We often assume that women are forced to veil, that somebody's making them do this. That may be true in certain countries, such as Saudi Arabia or Iran, if you are in public space. But in many places, wearing the veil is a choice, and women do so for various reasons. Some do, in fact, wear the veil to try to protect themselves in public spaces. Egypt, for example, where sexual harassment is increasingly widespread, and it is so prevalent that no one really escapes it. It used to be that if you put the veil on, if you were taking the bus or whatever to get to work, that people would recognize that as a sign that you were a decent, believing woman, and if they wanted a good time, they could go find somebody else to hang around with. There are some women who see this as their own personal jihad in the proper sense of that term, which is a struggle, the struggle within oneself to live a righteous life, and that because this is an expression of piety and righteousness, that really isn't always easy
to wear, it becomes a test to themselves as to whether they can be faithful to what they believe God expects of them. There are some places today where veils are being increasingly banned at different levels. Turkey has certainly been in the news over this, as has France. This is one of my favorite political cartoons, because it asks us to shake it up a little bit in terms of our expectations. Who is really being dominated by male culture? Do we have more freedom if we can strip down to practically nothing? Or do we have more freedom if we can choose how much of our bodies and our beauty we choose to share with other people and have some control over in what context that takes place? Probably the place where this has become most notorious has been in France with the recent burkini ban that you may have heard about. These are Islamic bathing suits that are pretty much, there's not a whole lot of difference between that and a wetsuit other than that it also covers your hair, but it's the same kind of covering garment. But I find it really interesting that in France, a woman who wears a niqab, which is a full face covering that only leaves her eyes uncovered, can be punished for wearing that in public space with a fine up to 20,000 euros. And if there is a male family member who is found to be responsible for forcing her to do this, encouraging her to do this, he is also liable not only to fines, but to jail time. And yet, in France, we can also go to any beach and see women running around in nothing but super teeny tiny bikini bottoms and nothing else. Nobody says a word, and somehow that isn't against the law, and they don't get fined. And so there are some women who are arguing that the social pressure is there to strip down, as though being in public space is some sort of invitation for voyeurism, instead of allowing women to have their own agency in choosing how they wish to dress. Ultimately, from a constitutional level, the question is whether any government should have the right to tell any person how they have to dress. In the United States, where this became an issue was several years ago in Florida, there was a woman who wanted to wear her niqab on a driver's license. And that went through several court cases because she was insisting that this was a matter of her religious freedom, which is protected by the amendments. And the response that she got to that was that this constituted a security concern, particularly in this day and age, because part of the purpose of the driver's license is to use that as an identity card. And so if you can't see the person's face, then you can't really tell who is under the veil. There were also safety concerns with respect to trying to drive wearing a veil at that level, whether you would really have your full peripheral vision available to you. Ultimately, the woman lost the case because it was determined that a driver's license is a privilege rather than a right. And so if she wanted to have this privilege, she would have to uncover her face, not her hair, but her face, for the purpose of having the driver's license issued so that it could be used as a means of identification. One point I'd like to leave you with is that wearing a veil does not have to reduce a woman's intelligence or capacity to contribute to society. We have many examples of highly accomplished veiled women. Tawakkul Karman won the Nobel Peace Prize in 2011 for her work. She is a journalist, a politician, an activist in nonviolence, and the co-founder of Women Journalists Without Chains. Long before the Arab Spring, she had spent 3 years protesting every single week in the Tahrir Square in Yemen against President Abdullah al-Saleh and his corrupt regime, and she did that as a mother of three. I really love this picture because there were actually three women who won that year, and two of them are not Muslim. We have Ellen Johnson Sirleaf, who was the first woman to be elected president of a country in modern Africa. She happens to be Methodist. And Lema Gbowee, who has been working to unite Christian and Muslim women together against her country's warlords. She happens to be Lutheran. And so here we have our three veiled ladies showing us what Muslim-Christian relations can look like.
Another figure I'd like to introduce you to is a very dear friend of mine, Dr. Paula Correa of Saudi Arabia. She is a world-renowned cancer specialist, has been making some very important genetic discoveries with respect to treatment of breast cancer in particular. She was one of the first Saudi women to be named to the Shura Council, Saudi Parliament, was also the first female recipient of the King Abdulaziz Medal of the First Order, and she also happens to be the mother of a student of ours at Boston College. She's a wonderful lady. And I'm sure this young lady is very familiar to all of us, Malala Yousafzai, an activist for women's rights education, certainly the youngest ever winner of the Nobel Prize for Peace. Malala is really considered to be a very mixed figure in Pakistan and amongst Muslims in general. There are certainly people who are very supportive of her, supportive of women's rights and education, but there are also people who are very concerned that so much attention is being given to Malala that it creates a false impression that Muslim women everywhere are denied their education and do not have access to schooling. And so just to give you some figures from the Global Gender Gap report from 2015, there are 145 countries represented in this report. Afghanistan doesn't even make the list. Sadly, we see on the right side that the countries of the Middle East and North Africa figure very prominently at the bottom. Much of that has to do with access to public space, political representation, and especially health issues. How much access women have to medical care, particularly for pregnancy and childbirth. But I think it's very interesting that Bangladesh, of all places, one might say, has moved all the way up to number 64, indicating that despite the incredible poverty in that country, that they really have invested very heavily into improving the lives of women. Perhaps that's because they have had two female prime ministers, Khalid Azia and Sheikh Hasina Wazid. Similarly, Indonesia, the world's largest Muslim-majority country, has also had a female head of state, Megawati Soekarno-Putri. And yet, here we are, the United States is number 28, and we're still trying to figure out whether we can elect a woman as president, or if we even like the woman who's running for president, if we like any of the presidential candidates. There clearly is some work to be done, but because the Middle East and North Africa countries don't do so well in this report, I thought it might be helpful to have some additional information about them. It's important to remember that many of these countries did not have public schooling systems at all prior to 1960, and so the fact that they have been able to build as many schools, educate as many people, and cut literacy at such high levels has really marked a great investment at the social level. We see gender parity for primary education. We see rising levels of enrollment for both primary and secondary education, and certainly rising literacy rates. One of the most amusing things is that there is a reverse gender gap, actually, that takes place in the MENA regions, where the girls often outperform the boys in school. And that is particularly the case in the countries of the Gulf, the most conservative areas. We have more female students than male who finish high school, who go on to university and complete both undergraduate and graduate degrees. So, why? Well, part of the problem has to do with the society itself, that there's still this thing called wasta, which means influence, and it's not so much what you know, it's who you know that helps young men to get jobs. And so as long as dad knows people who work in the ministry of whatever, they're not too worried about finishing that education because they know that employment is around the corner. That is changing rapidly in Saudi Arabia with Vision 2030. One thing that is really being put into place at a remarkable pace, we'll see if it's sustainable, is the idea of accountability for jobs. Salaries are being cut, expectation levels are rising. We see it in the Emirates as well. There's a very amusing story of one of the leading princes who decided to make a visit one day in the middle of the workday to see who was actually in their office, and was not pleased to find that none of the ministers happened to be at work that day. So there were a lot of people who got sacked. So this idea that who you know rather than what you know is important is starting to change. And there are certain fields in which female employees are preferred. Information technology happens to be one of the big ones. In the Gulf countries, they find that women are more likely to pay attention to the details, and they tend to be better programmers, and they also tend to be more comprehensive in the way that they look at how IT is supposed to function in the workplace. Well, that is not to say that there are not education challenges that remain. There certainly are, particularly in Pakistan and Afghanistan, where we see girls' education lagging very far behind that of boys. Although I should also mention that boys' education remains an issue as well. We have very low enrollment rates for both of them. Family preference tends to be, if anybody's going to get an education, it should be boys rather than girls, because there's still an expectation for girls that they're going to grow up to be housewives and mothers. In Afghanistan, girls' education was prohibited by the Taliban for the 5 years that they were in power. And so to get from 0 to 37% enrollment is pretty significant over a short period of time, but there is clearly a long way to go. Part of the problem is that governments do not seem to be as serious about investing in education as they are in, let's say, military expenditures. 3% really isn't much to spend on quality education. So some of the challenges that remain, one of the biggest challenges to engaging in genuine social reform. In the United States, we like to see that somebody's passed a law, or that there's been an amendment made to the Constitution, or that some government minister or king or president or whatever said something really important. My own experience is that those things are nice, but oftentimes they're window dressing. What really matters is whether there is a system in place that is going to enforce and implement the decisions that are made. So one example from Saudi Arabia was that it was decided a number of years ago that only women would be permitted to sell lingerie to other women, because it's kind of weird in a gender segregated society if you have to go in and buy your underwear from some strange man that you've never met before. So there were some women who protested against this, saying, well, you know, but if I'm going to go and buy something attractive for my husband, I'd really like to have a man's opinion as to what he thinks of this thing I'm thinking about buying. Other women said this is just much too humiliating, much too embarrassing, and we'd rather purchase from other women. One of the other complications in Saudi Arabia is there are no changing rooms, so you can't try things on at the store. You have to buy it and take it home, and then if it doesn't fit or whatever, then you have to find a way back to the store to replace it. So the government issued an edict, at any rate, saying that only female salespersons would be permitted to do this. It took over 3 years to enforce it because the political will wasn't there. The store said, well, you know, but there aren't any female salespersons who are qualified. No, no, we're going to set up a training program. They set up a training program. But it took quite a few years until the political will was there in order to implement these changes. And so that's really one of the biggest challenges that I see. It's nice to have laws. It's much more important to actually enforce them. One of the other big remaining challenges has to do with the strong urban-rural divide that exists in many places, although these demographics are always changing. One of the big untold stories in many developing countries is that there is a mass exodus from the rural areas to the urban areas. In 1960, to give you an example, only about 10% of Saudis lived in cities. Today, that figure is closer to 85%, and it is expected to hit somewhere between 90 and 95% by 2020. People move to the cities because there are more amenities that are available, there's better education, there are more job opportunities there. And so some of the issues between the urban-rural divide may increase over time, not because anybody's doing anything useful about it, but simply because the populations are changing locations. Overall, I hope that I have given you an image of hope to conclude with, that there are many women activists in different fields. Bless you. Some of them are religious figures, some of them are professional figures, but as we see rising access to education and certainly opportunities for women, we're seeing more women discovering that, in fact, they do have agency, and that it's very important not just to have people coming in from other places to tell them what their issues are,
but rather to be able to identify that for themselves. What do I care about? Every group of Saudi women I meet with tells me how irritating it is every time Westerners come over because all we want to do is talk about driving. And nobody ever wants to talk about things that they actually care about, like expanded access to divorce, like being able to retain custody over their children in the event of divorce. And more important than anything else would be getting rid of the guardianship system, which requires a woman's male guardian to make all sorts of decisions for her and give her permission to do just about anything. Even Dr. Paulo Correa, world-renowned cancer researcher and specialist and member of the Shura Council, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, has to have a letter from her son giving his permission for her to travel multiple times to the United States. It's a very painful topic to talk about, but it is part of the reality. So rather than me getting the last word on this, I'd like to introduce you to a wonderful young lady named Yuna, who is a pop singer from Malaysia.
She thinks she's all alone, and all her hopes are gone. And so I wrote this song so she can move along. When things were bad, she was in despair. When things were bad, and you were never there. When things were bad, she came up for air. She said a little prayer, and she found herself. Yeah, she's gone out of her face. She don't need no rescue, and now she's okay. And all her tears were dry. She kissed her fears goodbye. She's gonna be alright. When things were bad, it was beyond the bed. She was scared, she couldn't handle it. When things were bad, but now she's glad. Can't you tell? She's walking on it.
So Yoni gets the last word for young women. She's trying to encourage to take charge of their own lives and to engage in agency, that they do not have to be victims, and she encourages them not to see themselves as such. Thank you very much for your kind attention. I'm impressed you managed to stay awake for some